Hello and welcome to Nursing School Explained. Today we'll go over the basics of fluid volume deficit versus fluid volume excess. If you haven't already watched, please go back to the video of the basics of osmosis and diffusion and of how that applies to the administration of IV fluids. That really applies to this video as well. So first, let's talk about fluid volume deficit. And I wrote here, as you can see, that can be either loss of plasma, which would be fluid only, or it can be loss of blood. So remember that in our plasma, in our bloodstream, we have blood cells, we have fluids, we have electrolytes, we have all kinds of things floating around there, but pretty much blood and plasma make up the major components of that. So causes for fluid volume deficit can be loss of blood due to hemorrhage. So let's say I cut myself with a knife and I cut an artery, so I'm going to be losing blood as well as some plasma in the process here. Now, patients can also lose a lot of fluids from vomiting and diarrhea. Now, that would be applying to mostly fluid or plasma loss, as long as the patient is not having a GI bleed. Then again, it could be both. Suctioning, again, can be a cause for fluid volume deficit. So that would be the patient that has an NG tube in place, that we're constantly suctioning out any kind of fluid and acid that the patient's stomach is producing, and therefore the patient can lose some fluids. Profuse sweating or elevated temperatures, so patients with fever who might be sick just to something due to something simple like respiratory illness, or even if the patients are septic. And typically the higher the temperature, the higher the fluid volume deficit can be. Drains can also cause fluid volume deficit. So if this is a patient, for example, who had major abdominal surgery, they have a major wound with 2, 3, 4, 5 drains coming out of this wound, collected in a JP drain, for example, there's some fluid coming out of that drain, whether that might be sanguineous, meaning bloody, or serosanguineous, meaning a little bit of serum, plasma, or blood combined, there is some fluid loss there as well. And if there's a lot of fluid coming out, the patients can have fluid volume deficit. Now, a major contributor for fluid volume deficit can also be diuretics. So as you probably know by now in your nursing career, diuretics are used a lot of times to get rid of some excess fluids for patients with hypertension. Now, if we give the patients too many diuretics and they urinate too much of the fluid, that extra fluid that they have, then they can become hypovolemic or have fluid volume deficit. So some major reasons for fluid volume deficit here. Now, for your lab values, keep in mind that we can only measure the patient's plasma level. We cannot access any particular certain cell and draw fluids from the cell. So when we draw blood from a patient, we measure what is in their plasma volume. Now, when a patient has fluid volume deficit or is dehydrated, that means that everything in their plasma will be more concentrated, because now we have lost the fluid component and the electrolytes, the hematocrit, everything that stays behind will be more concentrated because we have lost the fluid portion of the plasma. So with hemoconcentration, all of the labs will typically be elevated. That means an increase in BUN, which is the waste product that the kidneys produce, an increase in your sodium, again, because it is more concentrated, an increase in the hematocrit, and I wrote that in parentheses here, because if the patient only loses fluids, so only uses plasma, let's say from severe increase in temperature or high fever, then the hematocrit would be elevated, again, because the patient has lost mostly fluid. However, if the loss of fluid is also due to hemorrhage and the patient has lost some blood, then clearly the hematocrit will not be elevated, it'll be lower, as well as the hemoglobin. Urine-specific gravity will also be increased because the urine the patient is going to produce will be more concentrated. The kidneys, being a major contributor to our fluid and electrolyte and pH balance will hold on to fluid because we have fluid volume deficits. So the kidneys are going to want to filter out or keep more, retain more fluid in the body. Hence, whatever they are filtering, again, will be more concentrated and be reflected in the urine-specific gravity. And then serum osmolarity, as applies to all these other things that are listed here, again, will be more concentrated because the serum osmolarity measures the concentration of particles in the patient's serum or in their plasma. And hence, if they lose fluid in the plasma, then the osmolarity will be increased, meaning more concentrated. So hemoconcentration is typically what happens if a patient has fluid volume deficit or loses volume, whether that means plasma or blood. Now looking at our nursing interventions, so if a patient comes in with dehydration, typically they're not doing so well. Any of these patients listed here, you can already picture of what they would look like. So our nursing interventions are going to be very, very important to take care of these patients. So first of all, we're gonna monitor our cardiovascular status very carefully. We'll be looking at their vital signs. Typically in a patient who has lost some volume, the blood pressure will be low. Just think about it. There is not a whole lot of fluid in the intravascular system, hence the pressure of that system will be lowered. In addition, when the blood pressure goes down, the body, every cell in the body is telling the brain, I need more oxygen, I need more blood, and the heart rate will therefore be increased. So most of the time, in patients with fluid volume excess, the heart rate will be elevated and the blood pressure will be low. Signs of dehydration here, as well as blood loss. So if I cut myself in a major artery and I lose a lot of blood, I've just lost some blood volume, hence the volume will go down and my pressure will be lower as well. In response, the heart rate will be increased because the body wants to feed all the tissues in the body, and increasing the heart rate will get the blood there a little bit faster. Now, along with our vital signs, we're also gonna monitor JVD, or jugular venous distension. As you've probably learned in nursing school, it's a very helpful tool to see how the patient is doing. A lot of times we don't look at it that closely when the patient has fluid volume deficit. We look at it more with fluid volume excess, and we'll cover that in a moment here. But mostly, if there's not enough blood volume in the patient's circulatory system, the jugular veins will be flat. They will definitely not be distended. We will also have to monitor their lung sounds. Not that this particular has anything to do with the fluid volume deficit per se, but anticipating if the patient is dehydrated, we're going to need to rehydrate them, and keeping an eye out on the lung sounds will be very important because, as again we'll discuss later on, if we give fluids too fast or blood too fast and the heart is not able to pump it, that fluid will settle right down in the lungs and the patient will have some crackles. So lung sounds are very important to monitor, as well as orthostatic vital signs. Keep in mind, orthostatic vital signs mean measuring the patient's blood pressure and heart rate in a supine position, in a sitting up position, and then in a fully standing up position. And if the drop in the blood pressure is greater than 20 millimeters of mercury in the blood pressure by changing the positions, that typically means that there's fluid volume deficit or the patient is dehydrated. So keeping an eye on orthostatic vital signs would be very important. So this will be all your nursing assessment data that you can gather. If the patient comes in with a certain complaint and you don't have lab results yet, but certainly this is something that you would want to keep an eye on. Now, of course, we're going to have to monitor strict eyes and nose intake and output because we're again anticipating the patient will need some fluid, so we'll have to monitor how much fluid are we giving the patient, how much urine are they producing, and does this, the difference in the intake and output, make sense as to what's happening with the patient, and also it'll help us keep an eye on the rate of IV fluid administration. Now, next point being, we're going to administer IV fluids or blood as ordered and encourage PO fluids, but checking the orders. So administering IV fluids will again depend on the cause. So if the patient has a high fever and they have profuse sweating, they're going to be needing isotonic IV solutions for rehydration, because we know isotonic IV solutions stay in the intravascular space, help to expand the volume, help increase the blood pressure, and therefore will decrease the heart rate. They will also help getting some of these hemo concentrations, some of these values lower down. Mostly we'll be using normal saline, and then also we can lower the sodium level here by administration of the normal saline. And of course, if the patient is fluid volume deficit because there was bleeding or a hemorrhage, then we'll be needing to administer blood products as ordered, depending on the patient's hemoglobin and hematocrit levels. Patients with fluid volume deficit, mostly because of the orthostatics, can be at a high fall risk. So patient safety is something that we want to look into very carefully, making sure side rails are up, call light is at the bedside so that they call for help in case they need to get up, and so forth. Because if the patient has orthostatic vital signs that are positive, when they change the level from supine to sitting to standing, they might complain about feeling dizzy, and if they get up unassisted, then there's a high risk that they might fall, and we certainly want to avoid that. And daily weights, we will also want to keep an eye on, because a daily weight is again another measure of the patient's fluid volume status. Strict isonos are going to be much more precise as to the exact milliliter amounts that we're replacing the lost fluids with, and daily weights will be more of a global idea as to what's going on with the patient's vital signs.